I think we've already started the cultural implications discussion. I was feeling that I could actually not do a talk at all and simply ask you, the questioners, to ask all the same questions over again. Because my work is much more as untidy as possible, which means I'm looking at the enormous amount of psychedelic use in the culture. There was a question about percentages and bad trip, and the question, just let me give you just a number or two. Since LSD became illegal and had no known medical uses 40 years ago in the United States, 25 million Americans have taken LSD. So the idea that it is a dangerous drug is undoubtedly true, but of those 25 million people, very few of them seem to have had serious problems, who didn't already have serious problems. Now, culturally, that's a remarkable number. And if we're looking at leverage in the culture, probably that 25 million is almost entirely located in the upper two-thirds of the educational economic establishment. So we're dealing with a very different situation than the 60s, when there were a few dozen people desperately trying to figure out why this thing you put in your mouth changed your worldview. So I'm going to talk very briefly about what Max asked me to talk about, and then we may move into some of the other kinds of research of which Roland started to gave us some with the surveys, these worldwide surveys, which are quite remarkable documents, and with an N large enough to handle one of the easy criticisms that can always be made of a study, which is, why didn't you have more people? And those of you who do that, that's something, if you don't know anything about what the speaker said, you can ask that. And you get kind of a small kind of merit point. And the answer, I think it was answered brilliantly, which is we did as much as we could afford. Not that we had any other rationale. So the idea that there are cultural implications of altered states of consciousness, when Max asked me to do that, I thought, well, that's fairly easy. And then I got that the problem was, where did the culture not get affected? And that turned out to be more difficult. So let me start with a quote from a curious Facebook group. The group is called, "I'm proud to say LSD has contributed positively to my life." That's the name of the group. I just found it last week. It is a closed group of 5,000 members. See, this is a very large cultural phenomenon, is what I'm beginning to let you know. By the way, the UK Psychedelic Society only has 2,238 members, but I'm hopeful. Quote from this group, "Some of us may never have even ingested this sacred material, but we nonetheless recognize its positive influence on a wide array of cultural phenomena, including not only the obvious elements such as music, art, poetry, prose, dance, religious studies, academic pursuits, etc., but also on modern science, information technology, parenthesis, Unix, Linux would not exist without LSD, physiological psychology, and micromolecular biology." A reasonable list. And I thought, well, maybe I can get away with just talking about the current situation. There's a term of art that we use called a renaissance in psychedelic research, which means that you've heard about half of the world's studies described today. It's a better metaphor is the camel has a tiny bit of its nose under the tent. When LSD was declared of no possible use whatsoever, it was the most researched psychiatric drug on the planet. And when I entered the research world in the early 60s, I wrote Sandoz, the manufacturer, and said, do you have any copies of research. And I got two volumes of abstract only. It was only the first 1,000 studies. So a lot of people thought this was an interesting substance. And there was a wealth of research that was going on. And the United States then basically said, not only we think it has no medical value, meaning it was a totally political decision, but we would like the rest of the world to knuckle under to our request to take the same stand. And of course, every nation is free to make its own decisions, but we have a reputation of being very unkind to people who don't agree with us. So, now there's a reintroduction of these psychedelics as tools, and you've got four spiritual and mystical experience. And you notice that the idea that you could use these for spiritual or mystical experience was not comfortable, even in this room. And that's something we might want to look at. That even though it was hardly unknown, it was still seen with a somewhat concern and protection and the various questions that came up. But the immediate reintroduction is of less interest, I think, than to look back at the 60s and to realize that for the first time in recorded history, there was widespread use of psychedelics outside a cultural container. This was what was different. What we know, and we'll look a little bit just as tiny kind of snapshots of a few places in history, but it had always been within a cultural container. It had always been pretty much, right now we have the ideal kind of psychotherapeutic container which was described, but there were other containers throughout history. And the problem from the 60s is that this widespread use without a container led to real, from one point of view, chaos, havoc. Because the adherents deliberately seemed to be attacking the primary institutes of contemporary civilization. Capitalism, commerce, deeper still, the idea of ownership, which is, after all, what differentiates us from hunter-gatherers. Materialism as a worldview, let alone as a scientific worldview. Here's a group who are saying, we're against acquiring more than you need of everything. And against that you acquire more next year. Education. We're against an educational institution if it seems to be preparing people to enter the workforce and to fit into a slot. War. In spite of the figures after 9/11 in the 60s, war was actually considered not patriotic. And it didn't seem to be helpful to anybody. There was a huge anti-war position in the United States. The United States has never had a draft since and has prevented information about the actuality of war from ever coming out in daily media again. So this is a huge, you know, the idea that you would actually feel that war is not a good thing to do even when you're overwhelmingly superior to your opponent, it's remarkable in human history. And then religions were called out for their dearth of personal experience and for their moral strictures. Almost all of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, and at the same time, an uncritical acceptance and adoption of Hinduism, paganism, and Buddhism. Often, all at the same time. So, if you can understand from the position of people in the establishment why they found psychedelics difficult, it's because the banker would come home and his son would be back from Yale at Easter and he'd say, Dad, everything you stand for sucks. And the father would say, I'm paying tuition for this? And the son would say, that sucks too. So this was The 60s were an impactful time. This was not simply that people were taking drugs and trying to find out what God was. They were taking drugs and being very activist about trying to reconcile their changed worldview with the world that they seemed to be in. That was from the side of view of the establishment, of everything that was being attacked. Now, how could altering awareness for a few hours or every few weeks have that effect? Especially since the disruptors were mostly young and not in positions of power, control, or leverage of any of these institutions. So this was what we would now call a people's revolution, right? A peasant revolution, perhaps. Now, they didn't really intend to eliminate all those pillars of society, but they did want to swap a number of them out. And the people who were about to be swapped out naturally didn't see the wisdom in it. So I will talk more about consciousness, since we're here, that, which, as you know, for many people, at least outside of this room, is still hopefully rooted in brain chemistry. But there was another important revolution that was happening at the same time, which is generally not looked at as part of the same complex, which was the revolution is of birth control. That not only were we having the first time psychedelics available outside a cultural context, for the first time in the history of the race, women were free to be sexual without the likelihood of pregnancy and all the life changes it entails. In other words, women could say yes to their desires just as men always have. Okay? And if you actually study the biology of human beings versus other species, both males and females are designed for a great deal more sexual behavior than any of the institutions like. And someone who had very little other insights at one point said to me, during the 60s, a small portion of the human race was sexually satisfied. And he said, I'm sorry, it was over. Now, that was overshadowed by the woman's movement, which gave women the power also to say no. Unknown in history, but not unknown in history, but fairly rare. One Greek play comes to mind. And eventually this same sexual openness was clouded over by the rise in sexually transmitted diseases and further restricted by AIDS. And having a number of daughters, we're back to condoms. So in a funny way, we've gone a whole circle with that particular piece of it, just as psychedelics moved from expansionist to kind of underground. Now, the fundamental, which was talked about with its six aspects, I'm just going to say it in a different way. At the most basic level, the common experience of people using psychedelics in the 60s, which led to all these changes, was the realization that there's a connection between human beings that's more than language, racial, ethnic, or even tribal identity. That we're not each other's keepers. But in a sense understood in the mystical traditions, we are each other. And if we are each other, for example, how can you possibly shoot at someone else who is you? You know, I know of no one who says, you know, I pushed over a valuable bottle of 50-year-old scotch and it spilled. So I took a hammer and I pounded on my hand. Because that's my hand. Well, when you expand that, you can see the implications. So that shared identity extended as people began to work with these materials, not just to family, friends, and other humans, but in varying degrees to other animals and to plants and to all living forms. So that in a sense, the vow of the Bodhisattva became almost common speech. And in many cases, it extended also to what we call non-living forms. because even the most non-living form is still made up of 99% empty space and a whole bunch of little teeny things whirling around with tremendous energy. And the difference between non-living and living, when you get down to that level, is very, very hard to determine. So people also felt a shared awareness with all matter, from the atomic to galaxies. Again, the culture was not exactly equipped to handle that kind of integration. So that particular notion, I think, is well understood by many of you, that sense of unity, or Indra's net, or Atman is Brahman, and so forth. But most of you, or a number of you clearly, as described, of having gotten it through trainings in a particular tradition or set of traditions. The change in culture here was a sudden and totally unanticipated wave of the easy availability of experiences. And some of your questions that you had from the prior presentation showed that same concern that was much more vivid in the 60s, which is, how could it be that there's a whole alternative way of having this central experience when the tradition I'm in doesn't have it that way? It's a long, serious, important, well-integrated slog. Well, what emerged in the other side of it were things that changed the world in a way that I think we all would consider by now beneficial. The ecology movement. These were all fueled by people with psychedelic experience, the things I'm going to mention. Not only the ecology movement, but a massive interest in habitat and a almost religious fervor to protect all species, something no other culture had ever seriously worried about. Many kinds of religious traditions, including a number that are here, are against killing people, animals. As you know, some groups don't like you kill insects. But all of those traditions basically say that's a personal responsibility. It's for our own members. It's not a cultural universal. This was not the case with the 60s. There was a new world view, and it was a view that there's only one world, and that every part of it is as valuable as any other part. A sharp departure, if some of you remember Genesis, where human beings were basically allowed to be universal predators. And the rule was that anything other than people of your own particular persuasion could be killed, eaten, destroyed, deforested, mined, polluted, without any consideration of the larger unit. And a number of cultures went under because of that lack of ecological awareness. You can read, if you superimpose on the history of ancient Greece, which islands had trees and built fleets and became dominant and then were deforested and couldn't build fleets and were conquered by the next island, which was still forested, it's an easy kind of, you know, make a wonderful animation. But if we look at the Mayas, we look at the South Pacific, the Portuguese, in their, particularly in the islands that they found, Madeira was absolutely chock-a-block with wood. You literally could barely land on the beach. But with a little bit of help from humanity, it became deforested entirely, with, you know, a few decorative trees for the overlords. Habitat self-destruction, at the same time we are against it, is also, at the moment, the most in human history. We're doing more to destroy more habitat more quickly than has ever been made possible before. So the revolution was hardly successful, but it did, you know, when I talk this way, no one is surprised by any of this. You know, why would you be interested in a species that are inferior to human beings? Obviously, we say that's a nonsense statement now. Now, we're fortunate to have at this time when suddenly the reality of climate change, and shall we talk about floods? Shall we talk about that it was not clear for some of us that we were going to be able to take an unbroken train ride to get here? Now, but there's a whole generation of people who've had psychedelic experiences who are packing the universities with a demand to know more and to do more with what they know. A hugely popular major in universities is anything with the word eco in front of it. The other group, by the way, that's very popular is anything with the neuro in front of it. And there was a wonderful study where the same bit of research was published by the same publication in identical format, but for half of the readers, this was online, half of the readers, there was a picture of the brain. The other, there was a picture of something appropriate to the research. The click, right, the click rate was double if it had a picture of the brain. Okay? So that we are, in a sense, enchanted with the idea that you can take the top off and look in and find these wonderful discoveries. I love these things where they say the part of the brain that is visual is excited when you look at things. And it's true in almost every case. I think, whew. I'm excited by science. And the other thing that's happened is what we would call social justice. That's also emerged from this set of 60s people. Also, for those of you who are more serious about physics, I recommend a book called How the Hippies Saved Physics, which was basically a bunch of Berkeley physics majors without funding. Therefore, they could do anything they wanted. So I've had the good fortune to live in Silicon Valley, and I've lived from the era of carbon paper, typewriters, and a mimeograph to the web, the net, and the cloud. And what's remarkable in this rise of the personal computer, never envisioned by IBM and other large mainframe manufacturers, from the beginning of the computer, the personal computer, the people who were inventing it had entirely the vision of the way we function today. That this group, and I worked with a group of brilliant and quirky people who had the radical idea that a computer could be used to facilitate language. Now, it's hard for you to realize that what computers were used for, or a cathode ray, was to basically show you a graph of a mathematical formula. And when the person who said we could move words around a screen was almost universally derided within the computer community, except for a small piece of one of the military agencies who funded it. And this group, who also invented two things, the mouse and word processing. Just think about the effects of culture. And that group, I assure you, was riddled with people with psychedelic experience. I consulted to it, I know. The name of the group from the onset was called the Augmentation of Human Intellect. That was the goal. It was not to produce products, it was not to produce machinery, it was not to understand computer languages. The purpose was to augment human intellect, and at a time when probably the computer that they used took up maybe 40% of this room. The vision was that there would be a computer on every desk that would have access to all of human knowledge. And a quirk of history is that the idea of linking these giant computers electronically was a project requested by a very dark side of the US military. US military has a budget which we read about. It also has what's called a black box budget, which nobody knows what they spend or what they're spending it on. The computer revolution came out of the black box. And the people working on it, who were mainly people who were anti-war, were terribly aware that what they were working on was an incredibly crash-prone system. And they were convinced that if they could only get what the military wanted, which is all these bases linked, that should there be a crisis, that all the military bases would crash. And so it was a kind of a pleasurable group to work with in that crazy way. And it really took a number of years and before computers became stable enough, so that was no longer the case. I don't know if any of you remember working with an early PC. And Apple became famous because it didn't crash often. Right? So we were dealing with very, very kind of primitive, you know, very unstable systems. But behind this personal computer, there's a wonderful book called What the Dormouse Said by a New York Times science reporter. And he was curious about the question of why the personal computer was invented on the west coast of the United States when at the time all the computer whizzes, all the heavies, all the people who were the full professors at MIT and so forth were on the east coast. And it's a curious question, which is where does something arise and why? And it was his conclusion that there was a, if we look at a Venn diagram only with three circles, the computer community, the artificial intelligence community, and the psychedelic community. And that these overlapped, and it was from that curious mixture that the culture changed. So if you want to look at what are the effects of altered states on culture, it's far more pervasive than really any of us tend to think about. And we'd already discussed during the day Carrie Mullis, who won the Nobel Prize, and he was asked, would he have made the same discovery without taking LSD? Because he didn't have the brilliant insight when he was on LSD. He was actually driving at night with his girlfriend up into Northern California. And he said, I doubt it. Because what he said is, the insight he just had by thinking, but by that time he had learned with LSD how to jump inside a molecule and look around. And we also had the comment about Watson, and the controversy is actually about Crick. Because there was a newspaper article where Crick said, yes, I did use LSD, somewhere in that place between the single helix and the double helix. And there are a great many people that said he never said that. That newspaper article was entirely invented. Because at the end of the article he says, if you print a word of this before I'm dead, I'll sue you. So it's an interesting article. Those of us who think psychedelics are of some value like it. The idea that the computer and DNA both came out of psychedelic experiences is quite a remarkable thing to say. There's one more Nobel Prize winner who, Fadiman, who also used LSD a bunch, but it didn't directly influence, you know, he doesn't say that it influenced any particular part of his work except of becoming a great smart popularizer. Now, the fact is now that thousands of candidates for graduate degrees in dozens of fields have already made use of psychedelic experience, as well as meditative experiences, to aid in their own discoveries. And this becomes more and more visible as the taboos about talking about it keep shrinking. So the modern world, shall we say, has been deeply affected by the easy availability, on-demand, altered states of consciousness. And that they have always been part of the fabric of civilization, but never in such a widespread way. And if we just take a moment to go back as far back as you want in history, let me give you a quote from Huxley. This was written 20 years before Huxley had any experience with a psychedelic. The study of drug taking constitutes one of the most curious, and it seems to me, one of the most significant chapters in the natural history of human beings. Everywhere and at all times, men and women have sought and duly found the means of taking a holiday from the reality of their generally dull and often acutely unpleasant experience. A holiday out of space, out of time, in the eternity of sleep or ecstasy, in the heaven or in the limbo of visionary fantasy, anywhere, anywhere out of this world. Now this is Huxley, as I say, 20 years before. Use of a huge variety of intoxicants in their multifarious forms is as old as humanity itself, etc. Now, Let me go back a little farther than often happens. Paleolithic painting. I don't know if you've, how many of you have been to one of those caves? Okay. I was visiting the cave, and joining our little party was a friend of our guide who was getting his PhD in Paleolithic art. And as we looked at things, he said, you know, if you take the substances that the pigments are made of and you chew them, and then he just smiled. And I said, silly, how did you know that? But if you go back and look at those paintings, and if you remember being in one of those caves, what's hard to keep in track is who did it. Well, these are designed so that they could have painted them in the front of the cave, but they don't. You have to go way back in, and your illumination is this little teeny, tiny bit of what would be the equivalent of a candle. And what you realize is they are done by a priest. These are obviously spiritual. They're done by a scientist. They are incredibly accurate. And they are done by an artist, mostly with single strokes, like a Zen painter. So at that time, 14 to 25,000 years ago, those functions were united. And from that, civilization, whatever we call it, has emerged. Clearly, the Eleusinian mysteries, their culmination was a psychedelic experience of one form or another. The mysteries lasted 1,500 years until those friendly Christians showed up and said, we don't know what it is, but we're against it. We've talked about the Vedas. We haven't talked about Zoroaster's revelations. Zoroaster, who came up with the idea of one God, came up with the idea of heaven, came up with the idea of hell. As you notice, some other religions picked up on that. Buddha's revelations, clearly in an altered state, not a psychedelic, perhaps. Though I don't know what mushrooms grew under the Bodhi tree. Jesus's experience in the desert, clearly an altered state. And people regularly use vision quests entirely to get into these altered states. Moses' experience, assuming, which is doubtful, that Moses was even a historical figure. But if he was, again, we look at that. There's a book coming out next couple of months by Rick Strassman, who makes the argument that the prophets in the Old Testament probably were functioning with excess DMT in their systems. So, the urge to exceed the limits of conventional consciousness are as old as humanity. And let me just tie up this piece by a philosopher who we all have read, Francis Bacon, in 1620, said the following. Above all, if a man could succeed, not in striking out some particular invention, however useful, but in kindling the light which should, in its very rising, touch and illuminate all the border regions that confine upon the circle of our present knowledge, and so spreading further and further, should presently disclose and bring into sight all that is most secret in the world, that man would be the benefactor of the human race. There he is. Man has been kept back as by a kind of enchantment from progress in the sciences, by a reverence for antiquity, by the authority of men accounted great in philosophy, and then by general consent. So things have changed. And I suggest to you that the kind of research that you've been hearing today, as well as the earlier research in altered states, is potentially a much more important than a bunch of kids getting high and having a wonderful time and disrespecting their elders. The research that I did in the 60s was clinical and basically a kind of crude approximation of what you heard before. We had about 120 subjects. I think maybe one of them took psychedelics at a later date. And I'm now doing some other kinds of research, which we may talk about, particularly working with something called microdoses, which are using psychedelics at a level below the perceptual threshold, which have no mystical implications and affect consciousness in a very mild but interesting way. So that's a kind of basic overview of what we see. And someone I was very, very close to and taught with used to say that enlightenment is always a crime. And I thought, I don't know what she's talking about. And what she pointed out is that culture, whatever culture we're talking about, has one major need, which is to be stable, to be predictive, that people know what their place is, so to speak, and that the road that you are on today will probably be there tomorrow. Enlightenment always says that the culture is the way Francis Bacon described it, somewhat restrictive in one way or another. And so almost all of the traditions we've talked about have had periods of time when they have not been popular, that they have been as radical as the 60s seem to have been. So that's the notion. And the research is continuing on the one hand, and the 25 million people, I may have said 24 when I started, but it's been an hour. That's, by the way, the lowest possible count. That's the federal government asking people to list what illegal activities they've been involved in. Just, and don't sign the form, but put your thumbprint on the corner. So that's the underreporting. Altered states are here. They're part of the culture. They're either accepted or not. Research will continue. They have the potential of enormous benefits. They've already had enormous changes, you know, have affected the culture in many ways. So that's enough of a presentation. As I say, you can ask all the questions you asked before, and we could have a slightly different take on them if you'd like, or different questions. So that's it. Yes, please.
Are psychedelic experiences brain generating?
Probably both. See, that's the easy, that's the kind of science way of saying I haven't the faintest idea. But what we know is that one of the problems we in the psychedelic world had early on was the profusion of paranormal experiences. And at one point, Gardner Murphy, known to those of you in the parapsychology world, visited us, and we told him a few things. And he said, how can you not be publishing this, all this incredible stuff? And we basically said what has been said this morning is we have enough trouble. And he was very sad. Because just as you heard that the realization that we can predict and generate classical mystical experience, very exciting for those of us in that part of the world. From the parapsychology point of view, we can also generate a considerable amount of parapsychology data on command. And as soon as you have anything like telepathy, or one that's even easier because most people like it, is called healing at a distance. The idea that the mind is limited to this box falls away as a scientific impossibility. That it's mainly in the box is quite likely. That's its own, you know, that's its in highest and best use, no. So will that sort of satisfy for a while? Okay. Oh, I did want to ask actually a question. How many of you have not had any significant experience with a psychedelic? Not had. There are a few of you, it's okay. 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 How many of you have had who have not used a psychedelic, have had a mystical experience?
Well,
not used a psychedelic. Not that you didn't use a psychedelic for it, but that you, okay. So almost everybody is in the, has had the same kinds of experience, and so here we are.
Now, I didn't understand the question. There were two. It wasn't the phrase. Right?
Well, let me try it again. The first one we was clear.
Yeah.
Okay. The second one was if you have not used psychedelics, and that was about four of you.
That's why. It's
right. Have you had a classical mystical experience? Not that you may have used psychedelics and had a classical mystical experience. That's a different group. People who have not used psychedelics who've had a classical mystical experience. Okay, one, two, all right, three. Okay, so here we all are. I guess there's many ways to have it. Is that any problem with that? Now, there is something, as you know, in the Buddhist tradition, and it's argued, that one should not use in substances which, what's the correct, the fifth precept?
Intoxicants.
Now I know the word is intoxicant, but it's the next part of it.
The point of heedlessness.
Does not cause heedlessness in the
mind. Right, right. And I did an evening with a wonderful Zen monk in Santa Cruz called Psychedelics and Buddhism. Before we had to move the room twice because so many people were interested. And of the people who were interested, almost all of them had had considerable experience at one level or another in Buddhist practice. What we found by letting it be known through internet that we were having this, a number of Buddhist teachers wrote hate mail saying that this, putting the two words together is an obscenity. That was one of the nice ones. But basically that we were evil degenerates because clearly Buddha meant psychedelics and alcohol. And that's a question that is curious because according to my Buddhist teachers, estimate is 80% of the Buddhist teachers in America got a start by using psychedelics, as I think you were perhaps alluding to, Alan, when you said you hadn't had psychedelics in 42 years.
There's a lot of phrasing. I was devoted to spiritual practice before taking psychedelics.
Uh-huh.
So I wouldn't say...
No, you wouldn't. Right.
I got
okay.
So phrasing is very important.
Right. But many, many teachers, early on in their practice, or what led them to practice was psychedelic experience, and they felt that they needed something which had a very different flavor, that the top of the mountain can be reached with a giant leap, but then you end up bouncing back, or you can take a long time to get up there and you're able to stay a long time. Is that a fair way of yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Yes, please.
It's actually more common, but I love the story about Crick. It's probably kind of part of the psychedelic canon, the apocryphal psychedelic canon. But this is still a fascinating story that Crick, you know, got the inspiration for the double helix from taking LSD. I tried to kind of look into it a little bit, and I was friends with a very good friend of his, a colleague of his, who's part of his organization called SOMA, and he kind of verified that Crick was very much a big fan of LSD and was known to take it and even have, you know, LSD punch parties and
right.
The rest of it. But it, whether or not he took it in prior to DNA double helix...
We don't know.
Psychedelics, well, LSD had only got introduced into the UK in 1952 via Ronald Sanderson, the first psychedelic psychotherapist.
Right.
So it's possible, it's conceivable, it's permissible, but whether it's actually reality.
Yeah, we don't know, and
it didn't.
And we like, you know, those of us, kind of, it's a fun and interesting notion. Albert Hoffman, who synthesized LSD, different question I asked, had Albert used microdoses? And the biographer said no. And then I said, well, three different people have said they had lunch with Albert and he talked about his microdose use. He said, well. So he used microdoses for the last 20 or 30 years of his life. And there is something about a role model that is of interest to me, and I'm hoping when I'm 101 that I can give very long lectures and so forth. Yes, please. Max.
Jim, first little bit of devil's advocate bit.
Be careful.
Only a little bit. But in in getting, if you like, a positive story, it's natural to maybe tell it from that perspective. So, for example, with the great leaps in interconnectedness and the computer revolution and so on, in this country, we would say it wasn't all down to that group in Silicon Valley. So
no.
We have Tim Berners-Lee, for example, who invented the internet.
Right.
Do you know whether he was all acid?
Never asked.
No, okay. It's just a slide.
No, this is
more interesting.
Yeah, that's an aside. The chances, also, we know that independent creation of inventions at the same time is quite common in science, and nobody seems to be willing to deal with that. But perhaps it's back to your question. Why would independent scientists invent something within a week of each other? Okay.
Sure. We're just saying there's been enormous creativity over the centuries, and it comes by more than one route. But I suppose the question I'm a little bit more interested in is for example, when you were giving us the example of, I've forgotten the name of the gentleman, who said he was able to look in...
Oh, Cary Mullis, Nobel Prize.
Okay, and I'm really interested to kind of deconstruct that a little bit, because it relates to other themes that we've been discussing to do with extraordinary experience.
Right. Right.
Now, a bit of me, when I hear many of the things that we've discussed, kind of feeds in a basic truth, which is that the mind constructs, and that what the mind constructs depends very much on the materials that are available to it. And so, in the case of the gentleman who peered into the heart of
the molecule,
a bit of me kind of thinks, well, what he's done, he's got all this knowledge. And what he's done is, in his imagination, reformed his visual image of what it's like in there. Now that's important, and obviously if he's assisted in this by an unlocking substance, shall we say, that releases his creative imagination, that's important. But it's different from peering, as it were, into the actuality of the molecule.
Right.
And so, you know, I'm kind of interested in that dynamic, really.
Well, you see, what you're saying is there's several... Let me take a try at it first.
Right. Which is in the basic question.
Yeah, the question that we looked upon earlier is, and I forget whose slide it was, which is, only when we have eliminated all other possible explanations are we willing to accept this was the parapsychology. Right. And the answer is a very realistic one, which is Cary Mullis says that's how he did it. He does not say, maybe it was just my imagination.
Yeah, but I suppose what I'm saying is that when I'm looking at this world around me, I would say I'm simply looking at the world, but I also know as a psychologist that this is a construction.
Well, not as a psychologist, but as someone who's had altered states experience.
No.
Okay.
I might know any more than one.
Okay.
But it is actually, it does follow, although it's not recognized by the psychological community.
Right.
We've been studying how the mind constructs the world as normally perceived for over a century. And all first-year psychology students will learn, you know, for example, about how distance itself is a construction, at least perceived distance is a construction. You know, it'd be part of a first-year laboratory.
Right.
And so on. So we live in this kind of...
Let me give you
where A, our own research tells us that, but B, there is a tendency to be a materialist reductionist as far as the reality of perceived world is concerned.
Well, let me give you the devil's advocate position a little stronger for you. A piece of research we did in the 60s was the question is, could psychedelics, which have this kind of wild, scattering, beautiful effect, and we heard the classic, could it be used on hard-nosed scientific problem solving in molecular biology, in physics, in pure mathematics, in architecture? And the answer at the time in the 60s was, oh, not likely.
I tried.
Well, but you didn't try it with our group. So we designed a study which had, as Roland studies have, a lot of care and understanding of not only set and setting, but with LSD, focus. And we found that if you had scientists who were, and the criteria for getting into the study, his study is you had to not be crazy. We didn't have that criteria. Our criteria was you had to be obsessed with this problem, and that you had at least 3 months of failure. So we wanted you intellectually obsessed, we wanted you emotionally upset, we wanted you desperate. And failure was it's a pretty high standard. And so, and we weren't sure that it would work at all. We had the same feeling that people would trip out. But we did everything possible to make set and setting positive, and every device known to the placebo world was used to say, it's going to work, this is exciting, this may be the best day of your life. And we had groups of four so that it would be kind of inappropriate to kind of trip out, because everyone else is working. And people came in, they were given 100, either 100 micrograms of LSD or 200 milligrams of mescaline, depending on what we had, which federal agency was not bothering us. And they put on eye shades and music for several hours, and then we said, you may work on your problems. 44 problems, 48 problems, 44 solutions. And the solutions range from a new theory of the photon, which was published, to patents, to products, to publications. We also gave psychological tests. They all did magnificently better, and no one ever cared. So much for psychology. People have said to me, well, might that not have worked just as well without a psychedelic? And I've said, try it. Meaning, of course, there's other ways. But what we did find is, in all these varied fields, that there were these really breakthrough successes in their particular expertise. Now, again, like Kerry Mullis, they had lots of information. And one of the aspects of psychedelics, which is not about spiritual, is an enhanced ability for pattern recognition. That's what's underneath the realization that everything's connected. It's seeing that it's true. So the question now, you can say, is of those 48 problems, could they have simply been solved using some other way, since these were all people who were being paid to solve such problems? And the answer is probably, maybe. But we won't, you know, the problem with reality is it's very hard to do a double blind.
It's also a matter of having appropriate dosage so that the people aren't so high they can't hold an IV.
Right.
And I mean, that was not, I didn't have such good protocols.
You sure didn't.
I couldn't even hold, I think non-verbally, anyway, I couldn't even hold a theorem in my mind.
Right. But also you weren't interested.
Well,
see, remember the variables were what we now call set and setting, which is expectation and the ambiance, substance, what we're using, dosage, and the kind of guiding or support or coaching or container making that was really described beautifully for the clinical setting and for the meditation setting. That living room you saw, that was really a design that we came up with in the 60s, and it's now kind of standard. Nobody does any psychedelic research without a living room. And there are very funny places in very strange hospital and laboratory buildings where you walk through and suddenly there's a living room. And you say, oh, I know what they're doing in there. That was a breakthrough. And the breakthrough was that these were not chemicals. that these substances, unlike almost everything else you buy at the chemist, had to be taken with inside a context. And when we look back into history, that's what I meant when there was, they were always in a cultural container. Just as the work from South America with ayahuasca, the work from the American Southwest and Mexico with peyote is always in a container. Because setting, substance, dosage, etc., are necessary variables. And these substances have another peculiarity, which is at different doses, they have entirely different effects. If you take an aspirin, it has an effect. If you take two aspirin, it has the same effect. If you take 10 aspirin, it's kind of the same effect. If you take more, you get sick. But it's basically kind of linear. These substances are not like that because they are incredibly sensitive to set and setting, as well as to dosage. So this is a very different model of the way we tend to treat things you put in your mouth. And what we know in contemporary medicine is most medications have an entirely different range of effect depending on what time of day you take it. And that's usually ignored by most physicians and most patients. So we know a lot more than we're already doing. Psychedelics happen to be, you know, a kind of quantum leap of how important that is. But it is one of the differences. And so it's very hard, and I try and do it in my language and always fail, which is to talk about psychedelic experiences, not about psychedelics. Because psychedelics is like saying, oh, let's have music. You say, well, what do you mean by music? Well, now we're talking about instruments and tempo and genre and artist and, you know, all the variables.
Why do you think psychedelics or psychedelic experience is similar to some of the meditative experiences? What's your framework for that?
Oh.
Is it all contrary to what?
Well, one of the things that you come to with psychedelics and with mystical experiences, there's only one reality. Therefore, let me quote Evelyn Underhill, lovely British mystic, who said, if God is infinite, he can be approached in an infinite number of ways. So the question would be, here's the puzzle. And it's a puzzle which some of you really know much more than I do, which is there a single mountaintop of mystical experience? Or is there a mountain range, and the highest in different traditions are actually different? Now, I would like it to be one mountain. But it looks like, as I explore different traditions with adepts and with people with 30, 40 years experience, it seems to be that maybe these are different mountains. For instance, in Sufism, one does not lose one's total, there is something called fana, or annihilation of the self, of the ego. But that's not the end state. The end state is returning from that. Just as in Zen has a similar tradition, there where one, and in Islam, one retains a separation from God. It's a love religion. Love, to have a love religion, you have to have separation. Okay, there are other traditions where the goal is no separation, and you retain it. So this is an interesting question, and it may be that we're going to be able to ask it by not only having adepts or advanced meditators, but from different mountaintops. And they can tell us about it. Yes, Bob?
What you just described, different traditions having different resting places, could that equally well be explained by there being one mountain, but recommendations about where best to hang out on it after you've explored all of it?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's a nice, it's something that you can easily play with, because those of you who are very serious in a single tradition or have been in several traditions probably have something really to say to the rest of us about that.
Historically, it is said that Ramakrishna, the late 19th century, highly regarded
right.
sage in India, at that time the two other religious traditions he would have encountered was Islam and Christianity.
Right.
And it is certainly said very much that he seriously experimented with these.
Right.
And came to the conclusion that they lead to the same mountaintop.
Right.
Although on the way, he describes quite different experiences. For example, he described that while practicing certain stages of Islam, he began to hate all other religions.
He was on the right path.
So I mentioned this, that historically at least there is one person who seems to have it.
Right. Now, actually, Ramakrishna's story is well worth noticing because he was this person we keep talking about, the adept who we want to have in our laboratories. And he definitely said, I think I will try to find out what it is like in this practice and in this practice. And he was developed enough so he could do that, and honest enough to notice that there were some problems along the way.
But he still, at least from what I have read, that he said that the top is the same.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a friend who says, when someone says to him, what's your religion? He says, is there more than one? By the way, I just had a kind of a visual insight, which is the central insight of unity, interconnectedness, the 10,000 worlds, however we have that. Look at the vision of the computer network. It's remarkably similar. It just says all knowledge and every human being or everything can be connected and can access each other. Remember Indra's net? I'm just noticing that. I don't think they intended it quite that way. Yes, please, and then yes.
I was wondering, a lot of the experimentation and all seems to describe what psychedelics do.
Right.
But is there some kind of a study or something that tries to understand how it is doing it?
Oh.
What exactly is happening that leads to these experiences?
Well, what exactly is happening depends on what field of expertise you're interested in. As I say, the word neuro makes everything acceptable. And I'm watching my smartest undergraduate friends all finding neuros to major in, those who aren't in ecos. So that's a question that is of great interest. For instance, why is it that if you saw the psilocybin molecule, the LSD molecule doesn't look like that? Okay? And there's a lot of chemical things we can talk about, and there are families of chemicals, but the effects of things are not predicted necessarily by the description of the molecule. And that there are families which are not chemically identical, but their experiences are identical. All that you heard from Roland was about psilocybin experiments. Now, since I'm more of a field worker, kind of a going from town to town asking people what they're up to, it looks like there are two reasons why LSD is not used in these studies. One is it takes several hours longer, and if you're trying to go home after an 8-hour day, you can with psilocybin, and you can't with LSD. And the other is that it has a much more well-known bad reputation. And the nice thing is most of the people who are against LSD can't spell psilocybin. So I don't know what that is, so it's probably all right.
Does it change the brain chemistry?
Of course. But not for long. And some of the early work, and I'm not too sure that how accurate this was, but there was work done with radioactive tracers. And it looked like LSD left the brain within an hour and a half, left the body within about an hour and a half. You remember the diagram with the peak? That's way before the peak. And also, when you're doing LSD, we're talking micrograms. And micrograms are really a little. We're talking, millionths of a gram. There's not a lot there. So they clearly are catalytic in some way. And there is a paper called the Chemistry of LSD. It has a slightly longer title. And when I was doing my book on this material, I thought, I'm going to have to deal with this. Because people are going to say a question like that. And I start to read it, and they said, we looked at like 10,000 papers, we've got 1,800 references, and we don't know the mechanism. And I thought, I don't either. So the answer is that it's very difficult to do the research that we've had been unable to do for 40 years. It's not necessarily, shattering science to do this, but it does take money and support. And unlike these studies that you heard about, which clearly deal with human betterment, the cost of these other studies are still there, and it will happen because there are too many graduate students that want to do research in this area. And I set up a couple of years ago a list of graduate students who had to have, in a sense, outed themselves as psychedelic researchers before they could join the list. And there are people really from all over the planet who are doing graduate work in a dozen areas, whose entire career is based on how can I work my training so I can do psychedelic research. So the answer is, I'll tell you in a couple of years.
Could I just say something?
Please, Amanda.
Since the 60s, it's been my interest what are the mechanisms underneath the workings of the psychedelics. And we've recently so I've been heading to all of that, those answers. And over the last few years, we've been doing research on psilocybin and how that works. And the action which is most tied up with the degree of how much you feel the experience is the degree to which the mechanism called the default mode network, which is a kind of scientific explanation of the ego, the superego mechanism, has its blood supply reduced. And now we're just starting doing the research with LSD, and I predict that it will also have the same mechanism as its underlying.
Now the nice thing is, and we saw the slides this morning of the comparison of the meditation study and the study that Amanda is actually quite responsible for and was a member of that team, that indicated that there was a high overlap between certain kinds of meditation practices and what we could measure and certain kinds of putting a psychedelic in the system and looking at the at blood flow in the brain. So we do know some things. What we know is it's worth doing the research. Yes, please. Oh, wait. Yes, please. You had a hand up and I squelched you a while back.
No, it's okay.
Okay.
Goes back to
can I just complete the question there?
Sure, try.
Because it's, well, it's like when you talked about those 44 people who got the solutions. You spoke about 48 people who were troubled with the... 48 problems and then 44 found it.
Right.
I'm just wondering, like, from a more psychological dimension, it could be that in the subconscious, people who do hypnotherapy and all, if one goes into the subconscious has a lot of answers already.
Right.
And it could be that the drug is just unleashing or, you know, giving an access to that.
Yeah.
So it could work also if one had done hypnotherapy, for example, or through different states of meditation, reached a point where they...
Of course. I mean, the question is how did these scientists have come to these answers? And the Western answer is pretty much what you've said. Now, there's an older answer which said the muse entered them, the spirit of knowledge entered them and gifted them with wisdom. There's a lot more history of that than the notion is that they overcame their childhood traumas because they didn't like the feeling of failure. I mean, I can do that stuff. So it's wonderful when we look back at older traditions and how did they answer the same question. I happen to like the idea that there's also spirits in this universe. Because every culture that I've ever studied, except this one, said there was. And I haven't found this culture so smart on how to function on the planet. You know, as a species, we're not exactly the best thing, you know, we've ever found. So the Western notion that everyone has always been wrong forever, and we are the first culture to know the truth, smacks of a bit of arrogance. So, is that true?
Undone.
Yeah, I know my shoelace is undone. It's a terrible risk, but I didn't want to tie it. Right. Right. We don't want to lose any of us. So.
You can't tie them well, we'll give you a bit of LSD.
Now, and so the question might be, is how much LSD did I take today before this talk?
That we know.
Do we?
The interesting thing about the microdose research that I've been doing is I basically ask people, is tell me what you're doing, and if you would like to have a protocol, which is a 1 month set of trials, I'll be happy to send you a form. I do get mail that says, could you just put some LSD in the mail? I read you in a, you know, I read an article about you, and I'd like to do that.
Can I say a bit more about that, about the microdose?
Yeah, the microdose is curious because it is the, Albert Hoffman said, it is the unresearched area, meaning with this dosage level, and that he personally used it for the last 20, 30 years of his life, which was only, by the way, when he was walking in the woods. That was the way he described it, which is meaning not all that often. What it seems to do from the reports I've been getting is it seems to improve, someone described it as an all chakra enhancer. Some of you who deal in the university world are familiar with your students using Adderall. Adderall happens to be what we would call in the street speed. It's straight amphetamine, it has nothing else is in it. And it has the effects of allowing people to stay up all night and actually get their work done rather than just stay up all night. Okay. But it doesn't really affect all systems. It's a straight stimulant. A microdose seems to be a mild stimulant at every level, so that when one is taking a microdose for a day, one can do one's work, not at a higher level, but longer.
We're talking LSD, aren't we?
We're talking a number of substances. I happen to know more about LSD, but people have been using microdose of mushrooms, of ayahuasca, of ibogaine, and of substances which are known affectionately as the alphabetamines, which is there's dozens of chemicals which don't have names, just have numbers.
What is a microgram?
10 micrograms. It's supposed to be sub-perceptual, meaning the world is not a glitter, and not even a little bit. And when that happens, and the answer to the question is that at the end of the day, and we've all had the experience at the end of a day, you say, that was a really good day. That's the general experience. You are a little more focused. You are a little more comfortable with other people who are stupid or who've cut you off in traffic. You probably eat a little healthier. If you went to the gymnasium, you would do maybe one more set of reps. Not big stuff. But that it would be a good day. And the reports I read, basically, after a while, not uncommon is I could hardly wait for my next dose day. and curiously, see, this is where we know nothing of the chemistry. Psilocybin lasts 6 hours. LSD lasts 8 or 9 hours. Ibogaine lasts 36 hours. A lot of things. But if one takes a microdose of LSD, it lasts 2 days. And a number of people, thinking of one who's the head of a major corporation, second day is better. Now, the answer to your question is, I'm working on it. This is discovery. It's what I call search. I don't really like doing research. But this is search, which is really don't know the implications. It looks like it has a very useful effect for the depressive part of bipolar, for example.
But it's getting very close to homeopathy by the time.
Say that again?
Getting very close to homeopathy once you've learned 10
microdoses. Right, but then homeopathy is incredibly powerful. Unless you have a theory that it isn't. I happen to, you know, it is. So whatever your theory is, yes.
Jim, what do you think of the instinct that some people have that the ideal condition to be in is to get through your day happy, contented, well, functioning well, without taking anything? Any enhancement.
Do you inhale? Do you eat?
You can interpret what I asked.
Exactly.
Any way you like.
I did that way, and you didn't like it. No, the goal is actually to get through the day successfully, fit, healthy, and helping other human beings. Now, I don't happen to have a religious prejudice about, say, a what's the little mushrooms in England?
Liberty caps.
Liberty caps. I love that term. Liberty cap. Who ever mentioned that? I think they were actually short. That's short for liberation caps, right? Okay, all over England in that season, liberty caps. Liberty caps are ideal for microdosing. Is it against one's philosophical position to not eat a mushroom? I mean, the whole idea that we make a plant illegal has a kind of, you know, Saturday Night Live gong show feel to it. You're illegal. No. Okay, so the answer to your question is, I mean, I drink coffee, okay? Now, the history of coffee is it's to allow you to spend all night in repetitive prayer. Boring. But with coffee, you can do it. Okay? Tea has another history which is not dissimilar. Okay? Coffee also at one point was considered a subversive drug. Again, since every culture that's had access to psychedelics has used them, probably every culture that has used them had some good reason. So would I rather, it gets to be a silly question when I reframe it. Let's do it more honorably. Would I like to not, for instance, I take thyroid, okay? I have a defective thyroid gland. I have some, but not much. I regret that I take thyroid, but I also prefer to be awake all day. So I make a moral decision, which is I'd rather find something that complements my natural functioning in a way that's beneficial to me and hopefully to other people. Now, if I had my druthers, I would list whole groups of people that should not be allowed to take microdoses. There's a wonderful, it was in Peanuts, but I think it has an older history, which is, what should an evil person do? And the answer from Snoopy was, sleep late. So that's another way of looking at it. So would you like to reframe that question?
No.
I mean, the thing I love about microdosing is it has nothing to do with any cultural upset. And it happens to be a small amount of a substance which people with no knowledge or experience have made illegal. I like the fact that liberty caps grow everywhere, and it's unlikely that a providence is going to say the laws of Britain are such that the mushrooms shall no longer grow. I mean, you might have climate change and really be sad, but then you go to Greenland for your mushrooms, but I'm not sure. So these are natural substances. We have made synthetics of them, but their history is, as their, you know, their thousands of years of history have all been natural plants. And the fact that this genus of mushroom, there's about 100 species. What's that about? Why is it that there are certain plants which have this incredible capacity to change a person's worldview? Why is it that meditation, which is after all sitting still and breathing, has the capacity to change a worldview and to change the very structure of the brain? I would probably be more nervous about people meditating on a daily basis. And as you described it, you would want more meditation. That's right. And there should obviously be a daily quota past which one is considered having a pathology of greed. Right, I really, it sounds as stupid as I know it does, okay. But look, if we just rearrange the names of the objects, it gets a little clearer of where our preconceptions, what in the Sufis call permanent hidden prejudices, which are things which are so deep that you think that's just the way the world is, it's not anything to object about. And one of the things we have is you shouldn't put things that are unnatural into your body. Well, what's unnatural? Well, something that has not been, that is not part of God. Okay, well, you know, there's nothing, just like, there's nothing paranormal. I mean, that's ridiculous. Nothing extrasensory. These are all kind of cultural constructs to limit thinking. And one of the things we know about the meditative practices, the chanting practices, the drumming practices, the shamanistic practices, and the psychedelic practices, is they all cut through these kinds of artificial mental constructions. And if we look at the, you know, if we look at the history of practically everything, it's been helpful. So I think probably that little look at your watch says it's probably enough.
Since you just mentioned Sufism,
Sufism
and perhaps psychology, I know a bit of Sufism, but not that much. How does Sufism deal? What does it say about paranormal phenomena? Can you say anything about it?
Well, I was mentioning to Alan, there's a book called The Secret Drugs of Buddhism. There's a whole set of papers written by a friend of mine on the use of psychedelics throughout Sufism. However, Mohammed was against all this stuff, except that everybody was using it. Just the way President Reagan was against all this stuff and everybody was using it. So Sufism is simply the esoteric, just to be clear, it's the esoteric side of Islam. Every major religious tradition has a kind of inner core which is a lot more sophisticated and a lot more demanding. Esoteric Christianity, esoteric Judaism, esoteric and so forth. And Hinduism is so complicated, whatever I say would be wrong and right. Which is probably why I like Hinduism so much. They say, oh yes, another religion, another god, another system, thanks. So I happen to have worked in Sufism for a number of years. I actually teach it to graduate students. But mainly I teach the tools that the Sufis use in order to help people let go of permanent hidden prejudices. And that's just a toolkit, just as there are toolkits in the other esoteric systems. I mean, one of my favorite moments in Buddhism is I was in San Francisco on a Sunday morning and I passed a building and I heard singing. Buddha loves me, that I know, because the sutras tell me so. And I thought, well, you do what you can. But eventually the devaluing and the kind of stripping away of the core of any tradition will happen, and so the esoteric part of it needs to be maintained so it can be, you know, strip off again. So.
To support your point about Hinduism, Wilford Cantwell Smith, who was the founding director of the Center for the Study of World Religions at Harvard, he had gone to India before the independence of India and studied there Islam. So I asked him, why didn't you went to India, why not to study Hinduism? He said, it's so complex.
Well, the wonderful thing about Islam is you say they just got one book. And it's really not that hard to read. And they don't even have a lot of commentaries. They have the other book is a bunch of sayings, which are, everyone argues, it's like the crick discussion. Did Muhammad really say this? Did he say that? But it's a clean little system. Right? Hinduism is like saying, I think I'll study biology. Just plants, animals, viruses, bacteria, mammals, and other. And I'll take 10,000 years for the first round.
That's too short a time.
I think actually Hinduism is probably something that William James would appreciate because of what we call pragmatism. Pragmatism is if it works, then you should do it. And if it doesn't, you shouldn't. And the nice thing about Hinduism is you'll find something that'll work. And you get to go to a lot of great festivals. Okay, we're straying a bit off the mark, but let's keep in mind that what we're here is about dealing with this this kind of elusive, this shape that leaves the body at death. It sounds to me like as well-defined as consciousness, which is no one doubts that there is consciousness, no one doubts that it is worth studying, and no one doubts that there is an infinite amount of variation within that. That is of, and the question for me is, what is of use? Now, I have devoted a lot of my career when it was possible to these substances because they appear to be of remarkable use. I later discovered that they had been used by remarkable people, you know, in every culture that we could look at. So there's something here about the fact that humanity and plants have a remarkable synthesis, and that these remarkable substances only work because they attach to places in the brain which are designed to receive them. Isn't that curious?
Yeah.
It's not at all curious if we're all connected. It's very curious if you're a materialist.
All of Ayurveda is that way, though.
I'm sorry?
Ayurvedic herbs and plants.
Yeah.
I mean, they just found which thing in the body responds to which plant.
In some cases, you know, for instance, with DMT, it's actually already present
right,
in the human
right.
body.
DMT is present in every cell of every living being, isn't it?
Yeah, it's pretty much
right. And by the way, it's not only present in every living being, but of course it is illegal. Yes.
Max's question. Max, I want to say one thing about Max's question. You just said something that allows another reformulation of it. Is it the case, in many ways you could possibly answer, but it could be the case that while the human brain has many receptors that can use many aspects of plants in specialized ways, it may be that certain plants are activating areas, this was Saul Snyder's insight, they're activating areas that the human brain had evolved to use differently originally. And in that sense, there is a difference between, granting everything you said, a difference between one sense of natural and not. So
sure.
There is a question of whether, it's an empirical question, whether there's more holistic value for all the same kind of goals you're describing to develop the system so that it might, on the hypothesis, it has natural things it produces when working properly, rather than taking external chemicals in. So, if for this particular purpose. So it's just an empirical question.
Absolutely.
Which produces the best.
See, the nice thing is, it's a moral and ethical question, and the nice thing is you own this box.
Yeah, I wasn't asking it as a moral question, it's just practical.
No, but it is a moral question, which is,
what
are the
best
rules? What are the rules, maybe from creation itself, or from the nature of physical chemistry, what works correctly to improve a system biologically,
right,
and what may be detrimental to a system
right,
in some way.
Yes.
And one of the nice things is you are a walking laboratory. You can check. One of the things we know from looking at the data is 100% of people did not have a classical mystical experience. So there's clearly differences between people. And the question of what's correct, mm-hmm, right? See, I actually do not recommend that anyone take a psychedelic. You might be surprised at that. I do recommend that you get some knowledge. Let me give you a cultural example. Last week, Yale University, I think it was 2 weeks ago, three students were, according to the news, first level, three students were hospitalized for using LSD. Now, those of us in the research world, that's terrible, okay? And I actually was interviewed by the Yale Press last night, because she's doing a long article about drug use on campus. And I've been to Yale and done some research with the students. Now, when you deconstruct it, one of the students took an overdose and took a whole lot of sleeping pills and went to the hospital. What was the, was LSD the chemical that was the disturbing element? No. Another of the three had a big cut, injured himself in some way while on LSD, and that's why he went to the hospital. And she didn't know about the third. What Yale did was send a notice out to all students saying, students should not take heroin, cocaine, or LSD. I said to her, this sophomore who'd never used psychedelics, I said, what'd you think of that? She said, it seemed to be one of the stupidest things I'd ever read. And it was embarrassing. This is Yale. This is the health service. So when I suggested, she said, what should they have done? And I, you know, said, I think the business of Yale is education. And the health service certainly is an education. It would be a good idea if people had science, had reports, had, you know, had basic, you know, kind of like anything else, which is, why do I know if I'm driving and I see something red, right? There's nothing inherent about stopping, but it turns out to be a useful bit of knowledge. And similarly, the question of what we should put into our body fills in the same way. I never touched coffee till I was 50. I think I missed a lot. But so I had your, you know, sense that that point of view of, you know, this it wasn't a very pure temple, I can't say that, but just didn't like coffee. You know, things change. And I think really the question that we're all looking at, we're all here to help each other. And we've made a number of connections. And I'm very excited that the serious study of consciousness realistically includes bringing in the people who have a remarkably interesting toolkit. And the thing that I love about the research is it's saying, we actually have serious tools to answer or to ask really interesting questions, such as yours, that we can actually, and the research that Amanda helped with blood flow, we really actually learned that the spiritual traditions were right. It turns out if you get your ego out of the way, that you feel better, right? Isn't that remarkable? Now, as you know, the other point of view is, why would you ever get your ego out of the way? It's all you've got, et cetera. Okay, enough.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.